Tent or Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Skeleton Dance by Aaron Elkins. Narrated by Joel Richards. Chapter 1. Once, the thing in the cave had been a man, but that had been long ago. As the years passed, it had lain buried in the rich, red-brown humus, slowly decomposing, its nourishing organic wastes feeding successive generations of flatworms and beetle grubs. Then, as the soil settled and fissured, the blowfly larva had come, followed inevitably by streams of ants and earwigs, and, later still, by the busy rodents of the valley, wood rats, field mice, and squirrels. Over time, the protective covering of soil had been largely scratched and worn away, allowing most of the bones to be pulled apart, and many of them hustled off to forest dens and lairs, there to be gnawed at leisure. But now the sounds of deep-chested snuffling and of strong claws scrabbling just beyond the entrance indicated that something more formidable than field mice or squirrels had found its way to the cave. A moment later, a squarish black head with glistening, excited eyes and a mouth filled with shearing, crushing teeth thrust itself into the entrance, low to the ground. The creature went for one of the largest bones, a partially buried femur, worrying it free of the soil with teeth and claws. It bent its head sideways to get its powerful jaws around the narrow part of the shaft, just below the lesser trochanter, where long ago the quadriceps femoris had attached. The massive set of muscles that had once taken the living man striding upright along the valley paths. With a final jerk of its head to set the bone more firmly in its mouth, the creature turned back to the opening and loped out of the dimness and into the sun. The next day it was back, and the next one after that. Dr. Emile Gressa, the longtime holder of the chair of paleopathology at the Institut de Prehistoire, scanned the meager assemblage of bones with a sniff of disapproval.
You've brought me very little to work with. It's all that we have, said Auguste Mariel, prefect of police of the village of Les-Eyzies.
He said it with a self-deprecating smile, but in truth he didn't care for Grisa's attitude at all, for the implication that Mariel himself, or his department, was somehow at fault. What was he supposed to do? Bring bones that didn't exist?
They look like something my dog might bring home, Grisa added, in case Mariel had failed to grasp the point. That is the case, in fact, said Mariel. Ha-ha, you've hit the nail on the head there, Professor.
The bones, he explained, with his plump shoulders jiggling in a show of good humor, were from an untended patch of weeds and dirt behind the cottage of a stonemason and his wife, where they had been buried by the family dog, which had been returning with them from its solitary outings for several days. The mason, a reclusive malcontent well known in the village, had belatedly notified the police at the urging of his uneasy wife, and the bones had been dug out of the Perrault's backyard by Mariel's people only an hour or two earlier. The dog had watched the unearthing of his treasures with indignation and amazement, and Perrault himself, beginning to regret that he had done his duty in contacting the police, had threatened legal action unless he was compensated for the ruin of his vegetable garden. Whereupon Mariel had told him in no uncertain terms.
Yes, very interesting, said Grisa. Now this may take some time. You can wait here if you wish, or I can have you notified.
Mariel chose to wait, drinking wretched coffee from a plastic cup and twiddling his thumbs while Grisa fingered the materials, leaning over them like a monkey lost in the mysteries of a length of knotted string or a pair of spectacles. And at last, at long last, he straightened up and delivered his pronouncement.
Yes, they're human. There's no question about that. Right ulna, right femur, right fibula.
He arranged each as he named it, so they lay in a perfect row.
Right first and third metacarpals, rib, partial navicular. Mahiel put down his watery coffee while Grisa rambled on. If there was no question about it, he thought sourly, what took you all morning to tell me? Except for these tiny ones, of course, the paleopathologist concluded, which I believe to be Apodemus sylvaticus. A paw. Mouse bones. You see, here is a tibia, here a little scapula, here a... But these others are human, you're positive? Grisa's chin came up. If you're not satisfied, you can always get another opinion. No, sir, I assure you, I'm satisfied, extremely satisfied. Dr. Bautier, perhaps, or Dr. Montfort might be. No, Professor, believe me. If you say these bones are human, that's certainly good enough for me. Oh, more than good enough. Oof, said Dr. Grisa. That's the way it was with Grisa, Mahiel thought. You were always walking on eggshells with him. He had dealt with him before, and he'd known what to expect. He was a little man, that was his problem. Like Napoleon, it made him quarrelsome. And since he was unmarried, he wasn't used to losing arguments every day, which didn't help either. No doubt it also explained why he was so used to hearing himself talk. Difficult as he might be, however, Grisa was a scientist of repute, and he knew his bones. And is it possible to say anything about the matter of death? Mahiel asked. From this, impossible. As you see, they have been thoroughly gnawed. Any possible indicators of disease or trauma have been eradicated. However, speaking as a trained paleopathologist, I can state with assurance that they are probably male. The general robusticity strongly supports this. They are adult. In those few places where it can be detected, symphysial union is complete, and they are possibly, I repeat, possibly from the same person. And that's all you can tell me. Crunch. There went another eggshell. Grisa's mouth compressed into a tight bud. As a paleopathologist, my area of expertise is ancient disease, he said. It may be that one of your modern forensic specialists, the quotation marks were practically audible, could do better, but I doubt it very much. You are welcome to consult one, however. He placed the bones, including the mouse bones, back in the typing paper carton in which Mahiel had brought them and pushed it across his desk. Good day, sir. Mahiel spent the rest of the morning pondering his situation. Under the French system of criminal justice, rural police departments did not perform important criminal investigations. These were left to higher levels of authority. Thus, should these bones turn out to be linked to some old murder, which seemed not unlikely, the responsibility would fall to the regional police judiciaire, headquartered in Périgueux. This being the case, his obvious course of action would be to notify Inspector Joly in that city at once and let him take charge. Yes, but suppose that no foul play was involved. Suppose that the reason for the sudden appearance of human bones in old Pierrot's backyard were to prove innocent. The result, for example, of graveyard remains exposed by the early rains, as had happened more than once in the past. What then? Then, of course, the great Inspector Joly would have been put to inconvenience over nothing, and, as Mahiel knew all too well from previous experience, he would not bother to hide his vexation. Joly was, in fact, famous for not bothering to hide his vexation. And the thought of that stiff-necked, long-faced prig treating him to an hour or two of oh-so-forbearing sighs was too much to bear. No, Joly was not to be called in, not yet. By noon, he had come up with a plan. With luck, he might never need to bring in the police judiciaire at all.
Now, noyons, he said to the crisply uniformed young officier de la paix, whom he had summoned to his office. Having determined that the bones in question are human, what is needed is to establish whether or not we're dealing with a case of homicide. Wouldn't you agree?
Yes, sir, said Noyon,
freshly graduated from the National Police Academy at Nice and newly assigned to Les-Eyzies for his field training. He was grateful for this early opportunity to show his mettle.
And to do that, it is necessary, first of all, to locate the place from which the dog has been bringing the bones, so that the scene can be properly examined, wouldn't you say?
Yes, sir, exactly.
And to accomplish that, it would seem logical to let the animal lead us to it, no?
Yes, sir,
Noyon said, a little less eagerly, beginning to have some reservations.
What I want you to do then, Noyon, is to find an unobtrusive spot within sight of the Perrault backyard, keeping your eye on the dog. It's brought home bones before. It will bring them home again. See if you can find out from where. That's your assignment. Are there any questions?
You want me to stake out the dog?
Marielle eyed him frigidly.
Unless you have an objection?
No, sir, no objection at all. I think it is a fine plan. I'm sure it will work. I'll do my best.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate your confidence. I'll get over there right now.
Damn, Noyon thought. You sure know when you're the new man on the team.
3 days later, a dusty and bramble-scarred Officer Noyon was back at his commander's desk with discouraging results. The dog was cunning, devious, two-faced, malicious, he said with a tremor of real hatred in his voice.
He tricked me. He wouldn't let me follow him. He left by different routes, and he never came home the same way twice. When he brought bones back, I swear he laughed at me. I know when a dog's laughing.
Marielle listened with narrowed eyes.
So after 3 days, we're no closer to finding out where they're coming from than we were when we started? Is that the substance of your report?
Well, yes,
Noyon replied, scrambling for a good side to things.
But we have several more bones than we started with.
Marielle lifted his eyes to the ceiling and resigned himself to the inevitable. He'd come to the end of the line, and he knew it. To wait still longer without notifying the judicial police would be disastrous. And turning to his secretary with a heavy heart, he said,
Get me Périgueux.
Chapter 2. The Perrault vegetable garden was scarcely large enough to hold the four men, one woman, and one dog that stood in it. Lucien Anatole Joly, Inspecteur Principal of the Police Nationale's Directorate of Judicial Police, Department of Dordogne, had been looking steadily at Marielle for some time without speaking.
You are telling me then, he said without expression, that since the matter has been in your charge, no action has been taken other than to observe the animal for 3 days?
He wasn't really surprised. He had had dealings with Marielle before, a puffed-up functionary better suited to have been the village postmaster, where he could have known everybody's business even better and without having to exert himself. Under his stiff blue uniform collar, the back of Marielle's neck burned. But he wasn't about to let this bloodless dandy in his fine Paris suit get on his nerves, especially not in front of Noyon and that old crank, Perrault. He smiled knowledgeably at Joly, colleague to colleague.
Well, it's not as if their bones were going to go bad in 3 days, you know, Inspector.
The bones, Joly replied without returning the smile.
No, the bones won't have been harmed by the passage of a few days. The site from which they come, however, is a different matter. 3 days, we may add, during which an active and inquisitive dog has been permitted, encouraged, to disturb the scene to its art's content. The aggravatingly superior tone was too much for Marielle.
And you would have done it differently, Inspector?
Joly, his head tipped back, eyed the shorter, stubbier Marielle down his nose. The man was forever arguing, forever questioning. In themselves, these were commendable traits in Jolie's eyes, but only when they went along with listening and learning, which Marielle, for all his quibbling, rarely did.
To begin with, Joly said crisply, I would not have permitted the animal to continue to disrupt the site, he said. Very true, old Pierrot contributed from the sidelines. There you have it. Not permit the animal to continue to disrupt the site. He scratched the gray stubble on his jaw.
Marielle threw him a scalding glance, but addressed Joly.
Oh, and how then would you propose to find this site?
Yes, that's the question, isn't it? Joly said, speaking mostly to himself. There wasn't any point, and certainly no pleasure, in quarreling with Marielle.
What is the dog's name? He asked Perrault. He doesn't have a name.
Sometimes we call him Tutu, offered Madame Perrault.
Joly turned to the dog and bent from the waist so that his hands were on his knees.
Come here, Tutu. Come on now.
Smiling, he held out one hand. To Marielle's amazement, the cur came, sniffing at the inspector's fingers. Did it think it was going to get its bones back? Ha! Good luck to it. When Joly scratched it behind a flea-bitten ear, the dog licked his wrist. Well, they said Hitler had gotten along with dogs, too.
Now, Tutu, Joly said, his tone friendlier than the one he'd been using with Marielle. Now, old fellow, we'll need to find out where you've been getting those bones. Are you going to help us?
Tutu grinned and wagged his tail.
Good dog, Joly straightened up. You won't mind, he said to Perrault, if these gentlemen and I take Tutu out for an hour and look about the countryside. You have something we can use as a leash, perhaps?
Marielle stifled his irritation. How like Joly that was. That smug assumption that the great and wise inspecteur principal could accomplish in an hour or two what the poor benighted police force of Les-Eyzies couldn't manage in 3 days.
Any particular direction you'd care to go in, Inspector? He asked lightly, as Joly was knotting a length of rope around the dog's collar. I was hoping you might help me with that, Marielle. Aye, if I knew. The wind, does it usually come from this direction?
Marielle gawked at him.
What?
Perrault cut in.
Yes, almost always from the northeast. It rides up the valley.
Well then, Marielle, said Joly, I suggest we stroll northeast with a good hold on Tutu, permit him to follow his nose, and see what we find.
Now that's a good idea, cried Officer Noyon, who instantly made himself as small as possible.
All set, Tutu? Joly asked, coiling the end of the 7-foot rope around his hand. Lead away, then.
It was as if the dog had been waiting all along to be asked. Straining at the rope, his narrow red tongue lolling between stretched black lips, he led the three men along the sloping shelf at the base of the limestone cliffs that backed up against the village, into a copse of stunted oak and juniper, and out again, still skirting the undulating, cave-riddled foot of the cliffs as they curved into the forest, away from the village and the river. Never once did he stop to mark a bush, investigate an intriguing hole, or chase a rabbit, real or imaginary. Without deviating, he led them to a fall of jumbled boulders that had dropped away from the face of the overhanging cliffs not so many years before,
one could still look up and see the whitish patch near the top from which a vast block of the limestone had sheared off and slid down to fracture into huge pieces below. Once there, the eager Tutu dragged them among the rocks, then sidled into a narrow crevice that had been invisible until they were almost on it. Pulling the panting, excited dog back and keeping it still with a handhold on the collar of rope around its neck, Joly squatted on his haunches to peer into the opening. The crevice was an irregular, waist-high space between the base of the concave wall of the cliff and the lower part of one of the big boulders that leaned against it, forming a constricted corridor, narrowing toward the top, about 4 meters long and less than a meter high. At the far end, dim and shadowed, was what appeared to be a shallow, low-ceilinged cave in the base of the cliff, what the locals called an abri, the sort of place that little boys were forever stumbling into and turning up one prehistoric find or another, bringing real and would-be archaeologists out in droves. Just over his shoulder, Mikhail laughed aloud. "It's an abri. Those bones are 10,000 years old. We've been on a wild goose chase looking for what's left of some Stone Age man. What do you think of that?" It was clear that the prefect regarded this as a personal victory. In the rear, the dutiful Noyon chuckled wanly. "We'll see soon enough," Joly said. "I'll go first." He handed the rope to Noyon. "Officer, you stay here with the dog." "It's the story of my life," Noyon murmured. With a resigned glance, first at the dirt floor of the crevice, and then at his crisply creased trousers, what immutable law was it that ordained that he would have to be wearing the new suit from Ochni's today? Joly settled to his knees and began to crawl through the corridor. Behind him, the amazed, deeply offended Tutu yapped loudly away. "Mikhail," Joly called back as he neared the end, "it gets quite narrow in here. If it's too difficult..." "Don't worry about me, I can make it fine," Mikhail snapped. And by dint of a few contortions, a torn epaulette, and an iron determination not to be outdone, he did. By the time he reached the cave, Joly was sitting on a rounded boulder near the entrance, trying to make sense of the jumbled bones and disturbed earth around him. Obviously, the body had originally been buried in the center of the space, where some of it, the pelvis, the lower part of the vertebral column, and at least one of the upper leg bones, were still partially interred. As for the rest, as much as was still there, it was clear that Tutu had been busy, and probably some of his friends as well. Dozens of bones had been wrenched out of the ground and scattered around the cave. There were a shoulder blade and some hand and foot bones and a little heap at the rear, a rib practically at the inspector's feet, vertebrae here and there, and half of an upside-down human jawbone near the cave entrance. All had been heavily gnawed, with edges and bone ends virtually chewed away. Many, if not most, of the bones were missing altogether. Possibly they were in the cardboard box at the Les-Eyzies-de-Tayac, courtesy of Tutu. Mikhail, on his hands and knees, emerged huffing and red-faced from the crevice into the abri. "Ha!" he said jovially, getting to his feet. "What do we have here?" Joly held up his hand. "Stop there, please. We don't wish to disturb the site any further until it's been processed." Mikhail smiled at him. "Inspector, I hope you won't think it impertinent of me," he said. "But I find myself wondering what process you are referring to. This is a Cro-Magnon abri, many thousands of years old. I assure you, I'm familiar with these things. You see those bits of flint scattered about? They are tool flakes." "I believe so, yes." "And the black deposits up there? The result of centuries of fires." "Yes, I thought as much." "The cave opening, as you observe, is oriented toward the south to take advantage of the sun, as was typical of the Stone Age. The rock fall which now blocks it is clearly recent, and this," he gestured at the skeleton, "is without a doubt Cro-Magnon burial."
There I have to disagree. I'm afraid we have a homicide investigation on our hands.
If so, I fear the perpetrator may be somewhat beyond our reach by now.
Joly was astonished. Was the man capable of humor, then?
No, I don't think so. I believe this is a recent burial.
Recent? Mariel shook his head. Everything here bespeaks antiquity. Believe me, I've studied these things. Observe the placement of the body, the flexed position, the orientation relative to the cave opening. Observe the fact that the skeleton is without any sign of clothing. Observe...
I'm not a student of these things myself, Mariel, Joly said shortly, standing up and coming within a couple of inches of striking his head on the stony roof.
The smug and gassy Mariel had finally gotten his goat, as he usually managed to do after an hour or so.
Do you suppose that's why I wasn't aware that the Cro-Magnon people went in for dentistry? Dentistry?
Mariel took a harder look at the broken jawbone, where he was dismayed to see the dull sheen of a gold crown on one of the rear teeth. He felt himself flush, hoping that Joly couldn't see it in the dimness of the cave.
It's, possible that I was mistaken about the age?
Highly possible, I should say. Now then, Mariel.
But on the other hand, the stung Mariel interrupted, with all due respect, it seems possible that you are mistaken as to the immediate need for a homicide investigation. Where is the evidence of a crime? Many people, villagers, campers, tourists, explore these caves. People have died in them before. They slip and fall, they are crushed by loosened rocks, they die of natural causes.
Joly looked at him, only barely managing to keep from shaking his head at the man's never-ending obtuseness.
And do they bury themselves as well? He asked.
Chapter 3.
All right, then. How does this one sound?
Joly said, talking through a ballpoint pen clenched like a pirate's dagger between her teeth.
It's just a few miles from Piltdown.
She smoothed a copy of Holiday Rentals in Southeast England that lay open on her lap, took the pen from her mouth, circled an entry, and read aloud.
Huffield Manor. Surrounded by flagstone terraces and overlooking its own 6 acres of wooded hillside near the handsome medieval village of Horstead Canes, this beguiling 18th-century stone priory has been converted to a luxurious 6-room manor house, completely renovated in 1997. Original beamed ceilings throughout. Large marble-tiled entry hall with a sweeping oak staircase and oak balustraded minstrel gallery.
Gideon looked up from the fresh from the printer's sheets that were spread over his own lap.
Hey, hold it. I think you're getting confused. I get half pay while I'm on sabbatical, not double pay. What does this place rent for?
I haven't gotten to that yet. Yikes, scratch that.
She went back to turning pages while Gideon returned to his own reading.
Okay, here's one. Cozy Stone Cottage, a rustic, romantic little charmer.
That sounds more like it, Gideon said.
They had been sitting in their living room for an hour, unwinding over wine and cheese, listening to Mozart and savoring the view that ran from Puget Sound and the pearly Seattle skyline a few miles to the east to cozy Eagle Harbor closer at hand, where one of the big green and white ferries from the city was amiably lumbering up to settle against the Bainbridge Island ferry dock, only 2 blocks away from where they sat, and no more than a 5-minute walk. The easy access to downtown Seattle, in effect one could walk to it from semi-rural Bainbridge, was one of the big selling points of their recently purchased house, set higgledy-piggledy with its neighbors on the hillside above the dock. The next ferry would be leaving at 5:10, and they planned to be on it for a Friday night dinner with friends and then a Mariner game at the new ballpark. In the meantime, Gideon browsed through the day's output on the book he was working on, and Joly fine-tuned their upcoming travel schedule, a 4-week jaunt to Germany's Neander Valley, to Oxford and Sussex in England, and to the Dordogne in France, in that order, scheduled to begin the following week. The itinerary had been determined by Gideon's research needs. Julie, a supervisory park ranger at Olympic National Park's administrative headquarters in Port Angeles, would be visiting one or two parks while they were overseas, but was basically going along, as she freely put it, for the ride and to provide much-needed logistical support for the notoriously absent-minded Gideon. Situated in a small rural village on the banks of the Ouse, within easy driving distance of Sheffield Park, Cuckfield, Piltdown, etc. Sitting room with river view, one bedroom, one bath, small but modern kitchen with fridge. She stopped reading and waved the brochure at him. Hello, anybody there? Hmm? Oh, sorry. Sure, that sounds fine.
What sounds fine?
He cleared his throat.
What you said.
She put down the brochure. What are you working on, anyway? The book? The book. Bones to pick. Wrong turns, dead ends, and popular misconceptions in the study of humankind. It had grown out of a public lecture he'd given a year earlier at the university, part of a Survey of the Sciences extension series. His presentation, Error, Gullibility, and Self-Deception in the Social Sciences, had been attended by Lester Rizzo, the executive editor of Javelin Press, who had approached Gideon afterward to ask if he would be interested in expanding the subject and turning it into a book for publication under Javelin's Frontiers of Science imprint. Gideon had agreed, partly because he was flattered at the idea of joining the roster of distinguished scientists who had already contributed to the series, partly because he was looking for something different to do on his upcoming sabbatical, and partly because almost anything that was still 10 months away from doing was likely to seem like a pretty doable idea, whatever it was. The $15,000 advance, ready money, up front, a startlingly original concept to anyone accustomed to writing for the academic presses, hadn't hurt either. Even Lester's first editorial suggestion, the first of many, "You're writing for the masses here. What do you say we dumb down the title a little?" hadn't put him seriously off. Surely Lester knew more about selling books than he did. So, stifling his natural reservations, he'd gone along with it, although not as far as Lester would have liked. Bungles, blunders, and bloopers. Hence, bones to pick, a reasonable compromise. He nodded, filling their glasses from the bottle of Merlot.
"Yeah, the book. I've been stuck on the same section for 2 days. I can't figure out how to get into it."
"What section is it?"
"You want Lester's title or mine?"
"Yours."
"The Case of the Neologistically Prolix Hyperboreans." He smiled. "What do you think?"
She made a face.
"Well, to tell the truth..."
"Julie, it's meant to be amusing, for Christ's sake."
"Oh, and Lester's version?"
"The Myth of the Eskimos, 2 dozen words for snow," he said testily. "Something like that."
He cut a few more slices from the loaf of French bread, loading them with wedges of gorgonzola and arranging them on the plate.
"Well, don't get mad, but I have to admit that I like Lester's version better. Not," she added quickly, "that it's as amusing as yours, of course, but, hey, wait a minute. The Myth of the Eskimos, 2 dozen words for snow? You mean they don't have them? Separate words for dry snow and wet snow and slushy snow?
Not 2 dozen, not 50, not 9, not 48, and not 202, each of which has been reported by authorities, most of whom probably know as much Eskimo as I do."
"But, well, how many do they have?"
"Ah, you see, that's the hard part. Maybe 2, maybe 100, depending on whether you're thinking of Inuit or Yupik, or whether you're counting lexemes or morphemes or derived."
"Careful, you're losing me, to say nothing of the waiting masses."
"Look, the important thing is, it doesn't matter. It doesn't prove anything. However many they have, it's no big deal. Look at it this way. How many words do we have for water?"
"Well, I was going to say 1, but now I think I'd better wait and see."
"Good move. What about ice, fog, mist, snow, for that matter?"
Yes, I guess if you want to stretch a point.
But it's not stretching a point. They all stand for water in different forms. And what about river, stream, brook, creek, eddy? They all mean water. Water moving at different rates in different conditions.
And you're saying that's the kind of thing the Eskimos do for snow?
Sure. And if some Eskimo linguist studied us, he'd probably say English is amazing. Separate, completely independent words for standing water in large quantities, standing water in medium-sized quantities, standing water in small quantities. She wrinkled her nose.
Hold on now.
Ocean, lake, and pond, he said. We even have one for standing water in teeny-weeny quantities. Thinking, she stared out the window.
Puddle?
Now you're catching on, see?
Yes, I'm starting to. It's interesting. Now what's your problem exactly?
I can't seem to come up with a simple way of starting.
Why don't you write what you just said? The whole bit from the beginning?
He looked at her. That's a good idea. I will. But his face, which had momentarily cleared, fell. What did I say?
Sorry, she said. If I'd realized you weren't paying attention, I'd have taken notes.
God help me, he wailed, but he was laughing. He was laughing more these days, she noted with pleasure. Not that he'd ever been ill-humored, far from it. But over the last year or so, she'd begun to sense a lessening of verve, of the essential liveliness and interest in everything that had always been such a big part of him. She'd pondered on the possibilities of midlife crisis. He was 44, of career dissatisfaction. He was a full professor at the University of Washington's Port Angeles campus. Where did he go from there? And even, but only briefly and when she was in one of her own rare periods of insecurity, of boredom with their marriage. It had taken her a while, but in the end, she'd put her finger on it. It was Port Angeles itself, the remote, one-time lumbering town on the far side of the Olympic Peninsula, where the university, in an effort to be ready for the sure-to-come population expansion from Seattle, had built a well-endowed, full-scale campus. The problem was that they had gotten there a bit too early. Port Angeles was a lively, attractive town in a glorious location, but a cultural center, a city, it wasn't. Not yet. And Gideon, she had belatedly realized after 5 years of marriage, was a city person through and through, born and bred in Los Angeles. He had taken the Port Angeles position, an associate professorship at the time, largely for her sake, so that she could continue working with ease at Olympic National Park. He'd never once complained. Indeed, in many ways it was obvious that he loved the place, the clean air, the nearby Olympic Mountains, the startlingly beautiful alpine lakes tucked into pristine green valleys, the laid-back atmosphere of the university campus. But no opera, no real theater or museums, no fine restaurants, no Mariner games. To get to any of those meant a 4-hour round trip by highway, bridge, and ferry boat. And when the weather was bad, a pretty common occurrence in these parts, it meant a night spent in a Seattle hotel and a pre-dawn start home the next day if it happened to be a work day. And so, little by little, they'd pretty much stopped going, except for the occasional university event at the main campus. That had suited her fine. She was a country girl at heart, never at her best in cities. But she had only recently come to realize it hadn't suited him. And so, when the opportunity had been offered him to join the faculty at the main campus in Seattle, he'd turned down a similar chance once before, she had encouraged him to accept, and this time he had. And they had moved to Bainbridge Island, still on the Olympic Peninsula side of the Sound, but only 6 miles from downtown Seattle, a comfortable 35-minute ferry ride. She had pushed for the move in an open-hearted spirit of self-sacrifice. It would mean a 90-minute drive to work for her each way, instead of her former 10-minute walk, but she'd found that it was a good thing for her, too. Her drive was beautiful and uncrowded, a relaxing, mind-clearing ramble over the Hood Canal Bridge, through grand, fragrant forests of Douglas fir,
and along the lush flanks of the Olympics all the way to Port Angeles. With a new flex-time arrangement, she went in only 4 days a week now, and she and Gideon were now getting into the city a couple of times a week for one thing or another, and, except for the one night the ferries had stopped running because of the high seas, they had been getting home the same night, regardless of the weather. Things were good. It had been a smart move. "Going to have any more wine?" she asked, reaching for the bottle.
"I don't think so, thanks," he said, smiling, just as the telephone in the kitchen rang. "Oh, geez," he said. "That has to be Lester. Would you mind taking it? Tell him I'm anywhere but here, and you don't know when I'll be back."
"I'll do what I can," she said, getting up. "But you know, you'll have to talk to him sometime."
"Not if I can help it. Tell him I went out for a quart of milk last Monday," he called after her, "and you haven't seen me since."
For over a week, his editor had been pestering him about the title page. Lester wanted the author listed as Gideon Oliver, the Skeleton Detective, making use of the irksome nickname that had been applied to him years before by a reporter and had stuck to him like a blood-sucking leech ever since. Lester thought that it might sell a few extra books. After all, he had pointed out in his straightforward way, a lot of people had heard of the Skeleton Detective, even if they couldn't say exactly where. But who the hell ever heard of Gideon Oliver? Gideon could hardly argue with that, but he'd put his foot down anyway. His academic colleagues, who were a lot more important to his daily happiness than Lester was, would never have let him live it down. Julie was back in a few seconds with the telephone.
"It's not Lester unless Lester pronounces your name Gideon Oliver."
She handed him the phone and went back to her chair and her brochures.
"Gideon, this is,
Lucien?"
"Yes, that's right. I'm pleased that you recognize my voice."
"Well, of course I would."
Actually, it wasn't the voice, or even the accent, it was the ahem. Lucien Joly, a formal type, wasn't all that comfortable referring to himself by his first name. Gideon had considered it a major accomplishment that afternoon in the little French village of Dinan, when the inspector had first done it. At the time, Joly had been attending a forensic sciences seminar in Saint-Malo, a few miles away, where Gideon had been one of the speakers. Afterward, they'd worked together on a case and had become friends of a sort. Later, Joly had been transferred to Périgueux, the capital city of the département of the Dordogne, and when Gideon had made his current plans to go to nearby Les-Eyzies to research the celebrated archaeological hoax known as the Old Man of Tayac, he had telephoned him to suggest that they get together. They had agreed to meet for dinner at the restaurant Au Vieux Moulin in the Les-Eyzies, one of Joly's favorites, on October 7th. That was still 5 weeks away.
"Is there a problem with the 7th? Gideon asked. "Need to change our date?"
"Change the date?" Julie said from the sofa. "No way, it's taken me a week to work everything out as it is. Besides, I'm only halfway through my French lessons."
"Not a problem, exactly no," said Joly. "But do you suppose you might come a little earlier?"
"Could be. When did you have in mind?"
"The sooner the better. I was thinking of next week."
"Next week?"
"Next week," echoed Julie. "Absolutely not. Gideon, I'm warning you, you're in very dangerous territory here."
"Yes," said Joly. "I was hoping you could make France your first stop instead of your last."
"I don't think so, Lucien," Gideon said. "We've been working on our itinerary for weeks."
"We've been working?"
Julie said to the ceiling.
"I really love that."
"Making reservations, arranging flights, and so forth. We already have room reservations in Les-Eyzies next month, at the Hotel Cro-Magnon. That's where I stayed the last time I was there, and I really like it. I wouldn't want to lose."
"I'm sure I would have no trouble changing your reservation for you. The thing is, you see, these rather intriguing bones have just turned up here."
"But we don't even arrive in France until..."
He stopped.
Bones, did you say?"
"Yes, it's a curious case.
they've been found in what seems to be a Paleolithic cave, oddly enough, by a dog, as it happens. And although I have no doubt that it's a homicide, I can't prove it. I was hoping that if you came earlier, you might look them over while they're still here and see what you can turn up. It would be a great service to me, but, of course, if it's impossible... Well, no, I wouldn't say it's impossible.
Up into the air in a fountain of glossy, colored paper went the brochures.
I knew it, Joly muttered. The minute I heard that, bones, I knew it. Les-Eyzies, here we come, honestly.
Lucien, it seems to be a little noisy at this end. Could you speak up a bit?
Chapter 4 Paris may well be the most beautiful city in the world, but its outskirts are nothing to brag about. Leaving the Gare d'Austerlitz by train and rolling south toward the Dordogne, one travels first through what seem like tens of miles of railroad yards, empty of people but dotted with grimy, isolated freight cars and passenger coaches that stand like tombstones on spurs that lead nowhere. Then come block on block of drab apartment houses, followed by grubby, gray suburbs that are succeeded in turn by grubby, gray villages, relieved by an occasional glorious church, all set in flat, featureless countryside.
Every time I take a train out of Paris, Gideon mused, I wonder if the landscape is really this ugly, or does it just look that way after you've had your eyes dazzled by Paris itself?
It has to be the former, Joly said. We didn't see enough of Paris to get dazzled.
That's a good point, Gideon said, nodding.
And what we did see wasn't that dazzling.
Very true.
They had begun the 14-hour, 8-time-zone flight from Seattle early the day before, arriving jet-lagged and seedy at 6:15 this morning, showered and changed at the airport, taken the Air France bus to the city, had a disappointingly so-so breakfast in a glassed-in street-side brasserie, managed to get in a morning walk around the Tuileries, and then caught a taxi to the train station, where a 2-day-old garbage man's strike had left the place looking as if it had been hit by a tornado. All in all, not a wildly successful Paris visit, and their moods reflected it. After an hour or so on the rails, however, during much of which Joly slept, the land developed some character, the fields becoming more contoured, the villages a little prettier and more individual, about on par, say, with what you'd see driving through southern New Jersey. But then, as the train moved deeper into the rural heart of France, eventually crossing into the département of the Dordogne, or the Périgord, as most Frenchmen still referred to it, there were increasingly frequent glimpses of deep green forests of chestnut and oak, smooth-flowing rivers, and wonderful outcroppings of limestone, brilliant against the darkness of the green. Gideon, too, tried sleeping, but although he was relaxed and comfortable enough, it came only in drifting patches, and most of the time he simply looked dumbly and contentedly at the scenes sliding by the window, or equally dumbly and contentedly at Joly, sound asleep in the chair opposite in their otherwise empty compartment, a single misplaced tendril of her glossy, curly black hair quivering back and forth on her cheek with every quiet breath.
You're not watching me sleep, are you? She asked with her eyes closed.
Yeah, you caught me. I can't help it. You're sure pretty. I keep meaning to tell you that.
She smiled, brushed away the tendril, opened her eyes and straightened up, looking surprisingly rested.
Oh, it's beautiful out there.
We're in the Dordogne. You've been asleep for a couple of hours.
Those hollows in the cliffs. Those are the famous abris?
Uh-huh. You're looking at what was the most crowded place in Europe 35,000 years ago, a real population center. The Cro-Magnons had just arrived, and the Neanderthals hadn't quite died out yet, or evolved, or whatever happened to them. Every one of those hollows, the ones you could reach anyway, probably had a few tenants at one time or another. The old man of Tayac came from one just like that long, low one at the foot of that double cleft.
Joly, still a little sleepy, watched it go by. You know, you've only talked about the Tayac hoax in snippets now and then. I wouldn't mind having a better idea of what it was all about.
Sure, what do you want to know?
Well, I know you know the people who were involved, the people from that institute.
The Institute of Prehistory, l'Institut de Prehistoire.
But you weren't actually here at the time it happened, were you?
No, a little before, unfortunately. I missed it by a couple of months. And the reason I knew them was that I was putting in a few weeks on that middle Neanderthal dig up the road near Le Moustier. It didn't have anything to do with the Institute, but I was staying right there in Les-Eyzies, at the Hotel Cro-Magnon, in fact. And of course anthropologists like to talk to other anthropologists.
Joly smiled. To argue, you mean?
That too, Gideon said equably. Anyway, I made a courtesy call when I arrived, and eventually got.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.